Good morning, church. As we begin, will you turn with me to the scriptures? The scripture reading for this morning is taken from the book of 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 11. Seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence, for by these he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lusts. Now, for this very reason also, applying all diligence in your faith, supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge, and in your knowledge, self-control, and in your self-control, perseverance, and in your perseverance, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, and in your brotherly kindness, love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they render you neither useless nor unfruitful in the true knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these qualities is blind or short-sighted, having forgotten his purification from his former sins. Therefore, brethren, be all the more diligent to make certain about his calling and choosing you. For as long as you practice these things, you will never stumble. For in this way, the entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, will be abundantly supplied to you. This is the word of the Lord. It is good to be able to worship with you again this morning. And I thank your pastor in charge, the Reverend Lynette Satyasingham, for this invitation to come and share with us this morning. I bring you very warm greetings from Trinity Theological College, as well as from Bukit Panjang Methodist Church. I'd like to begin by telling you this true account. It was in the 3rd century AD that a cultured, eloquent, and popular preacher came on the scene. He was tall, probably dark, since he came from North Africa, and possibly handsome. He was also religious and eloquent, qualities that most look for in their pastors or their preachers. It was little wonder that he gained popularity very quickly, and he was one of the preachers or presbyters in one of the mega churches of his time. This was the church in Alexandria. And he gained popularity as well as a large following in a short span of time. His ideas were deeply attractive, because they offered a rationality, sort of a satisfying model of the relationship between the Father and the Son. Furthermore, his charismatic preaching resonated with the people. In trying to make sense of the relationship between God and Jesus, this preacher began with the basic idea that the divine essence is an indivisible unity. To him, God is not a substance that can be divided or distributed like helpings of mashed potato. You cannot divide God that way. His premise is that the very substance of God is indivisible, and what follows is his belief and teaching that it was impossible for God to beget a divine son. For such a begetting or generation of a son would involve dividing the inherently indivisible. And so to him, the divine logos was not uncreated, but rather was the first of all of God's creation. And through the divine logos, the son, God created all the rest of creation. By his logic that the divine is inherently indivisible, the divine logos is hence not of the same substance as God, but of similar substance. It is perhaps akin to the dictum that you often hear, often read about on Thai t-shirts that says, same, same, but different. And so he propagated this teaching that the Son was not of the same substance as the Father, but rather that the Son was of similar substance. In the mind of this preacher, similar is very different from same. And the word he used to describe the divine logos in relation to God was this word called homoiousios, right? Homoiousios, similar substance. The relation, the condensed version of his teaching may be summarized in a dictum that he made very, very popular. So again, as a popular preacher, he sort of condensed everything nicely into dictums that people could remember. And so he says, there was a time when he was not. There was a time when the divine logos was not. He here refers to Jesus, the Son of God. In trying to explain the relationship between the Father and the Son, this preacher was careful to explain that although the divine logos is distinct from God, he is nonetheless still to be worshipped as being unspeakably exalted above all other creatures. He is the immediate creator, the governor of the universe, and the redeemer of mankind. You all are probably wondering, where am I going with this person that I have sketched in this opening paragraph of my sharing today? I don't know if you have any idea who this person is, but well, I would tell you that long before there were people like Kenneth Copeland or Kenneth Hagin, Benny Hinn, Joel Osteen, Stephen Furtick, and a few others, including some local megachurch pastors whom I will not mention, there was this ultra-charismatic, hugely popular and persuasive preacher or presbyter, and his name is Arius. Arius. What happened in the 3rd century ultimately led to the gathering of a council to clearly define our understanding of the relationship between God the Father and God the Son, the divine logos. I hope you realize by now that Arius's preaching and teaching was finally exposed for what it really was, heresy. And the person that came to our rescue in challenging this unorthodox teachings was another dark-skinned Egyptian bishop who dared to stand against what was theologically fashionable in his time. And he defended and defined orthodox teachings of Jesus Christ. He was nicknamed the Black Dwarf, as he too was from Africa and perhaps stood in stark contrast with the tall, dark, handsome, and saccharine tongue charismatic preacher Arius. But thankfully, this Black Dwarf stood the ground and defended the faith. Church, as we continue, will you join me as we come before the Lord in prayer? Let us pray. God, the source of all light, by your word, give light to our lives. Amen. Turning to the passage in 2 Peter chapter 1, this epistle was written at the time when Peter was imprisoned by Nero. Aware of his impending martyrdom, this was to be Peter's farewell address to the churches that he had helped to establish around Asia Minor. I'm quite envious of the fact that Pastor Lynette is going to bring a group up to Greece and Turkey as well. You probably see some of these churches that Peter would have helped establish. Peter began his address by offering a final challenge that Jesus' followers must be people who never stop growing. Right? He was keenly aware that the church faced two grave challenges at that point of time when he wrote this letter. The church had to contend with growing number of false teachers who were teaching and leading the Christians in those church communities astray. First, by their corrupt way of life, and second, by their distorted theology. So you could tell the way that these people were leading the church because they were corrupt. Peter says that if you read the following chapters of 2 Peter, their ways were corrupt, their theology was wrong. And in the midst of these religious pretenders and theological scammers, who would go so far as to also deny the second return of Jesus. So if you read 2 Peter chapter 3, you realize that these are the people who are saying that, no, Jesus is not coming back. Peter's goal here was to encourage the Christians to be grounded as participants in God's divine nature. He reminded his readers that faith in Jesus Christ was not based upon myths, neither were they based on clever stories. But the foundation was laid upon the sure revelation of God, as well as the testimony of the eyewitness and apostles. This is where you read, again, if you follow the versing in chapter 1, verses 16 to 21, that there are concrete evidences of people who were eyewitnesses to who Jesus is. Amidst the challenges of heterodoxy and heresy, Peter urged the believers to continue to grow in their saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so in this opening address, Peter then lists also seven traits these Christians were to strive for. The seven traits were excellence, in some versions is rendered goodness, knowledge, self-control, godliness, perseverance or endurance, and a brotherly kindness, and not least of all, love. It should be noted at least that these seven were not listed in any sequential or hierarchical order. Right? They were not listed in any kind of order. It's just something that Peter was thinking about and he wrote this down. Except for the final one that encompasses and crowns all the other, and that is love. Love was really the basis of all of it. For Peter, to love is to share in God's own life, something he talks about, the divine nature. With this information as the context for Peter's final admonition, I was asked to focus on the significance of one of the seven qualities, specifically that of knowledge. Right? Knowledge. So if you look at that word itself and you look at the Greek translation, the word is epignosis. Epignosis. And it is a significant term in 2 Peter. It is perhaps interesting to note that the false teachers were emphasizing also the priority of knowledge. Right? And the word that is used there, the Greek term that was used for what they were emphasizing it on was gnosis. Right? Compare epignosis with gnosis. And so Peter wrote in encouraging the believers that true knowledge, epignosis of God and of Jesus our Lord, excels the false knowledge of his opponents whose immoral behavior discredits them. Peter contends that against the falsehoods, true knowledge of Christ produces grace and peace, something he begins his letter with in 2 Peter chapter 1. Right? Grace and peace was what the two qualities that he engages the congregation with. True knowledge also then leads for Peter to godliness and holiness, something he actually fleshes out in the passage for us today. Perhaps the question is, how do we grow in knowledge, especially in our modern context of fake news, scams, propaganda, misinformation, disinformation, and outright media gaslighting? How do you even ensure that what you're reading on social media presents a reasonable and objective perspective? Right? If you think about it, how do you know what you're reading, what you're exposed to is actually very objective way of reporting? Well, we are less than 3 weeks away from the presidential elections in the United States. There are some, maybe in this congregation as well, who are rooting for Trump, while others think that Harris holds out some hope. Well, I think neither candidates are going to be of any help in regard to the situation in Gaza or the growing trade and territorial confrontation with China. And as my godbrother wisely made this observation, one, you cannot trust. The other, you dare not trust. I leave it for you to decide who is what. Right? One, you cannot trust. The other, you dare not trust. This current fracture in American society was in many ways facilitated by various deeply divisive and questionable policies enacted by, first of all, Obama administration, where you have the pro-LGBTQ policies, including the transgender bathroom regulations, which then subsequently fueled the rise of Trump's MAGA mania. How did America come to such a divide in ideology? What will it take to get them back to being the city on a hill? Right, if you think about it and take a step backwards, we may surmise that perhaps the root of this current toxic divide may be explained by the almost prophetic tenor of a significant book written by a historian almost three decades earlier on. The historian's name is Mark Noll, N-O-L-L, and the book I'm referring to is The Scandal of the Evangelical Mind. The Scandal of the Evangelical Mind. Noll famously went for the jugular in his opening statement that he says, the scandal of the evangelical mind is that there is not much of an evangelical mind. Noll laments the atrophy of the intellect in his strident critique. Evangelicals do not characteristically look to the intellectual life as an arena in which to glorify God, because at least in America, our history has been pragmatic, populist, charismatic, and technological more than intellectual. Right? I hope you understood what he was trying to say, that in the popular life, even of the evangelical Christians, they were focusing on things that were pragmatic, populist, charismatic, technological, rather than intellectual. Basically, Noll is highlighting the growing anti-intellectualism that is impacting both society as well as church. This was 30 years ago, right? In the same tenor, John Stott noted in his book, Your Mind Matters, and I quote him saying, the spirit of anti-intellectualism is prevalent today. The modern world breeds pragmatists whose first question is not, is it true, but does it work? Right? The modern world breeds pragmatists. The first question we ask is not whether it's true, it is whether it works. And this perhaps explains why there are so many how-to books, right? How-to books, there's so many of them. It's also evident in Christian book titles, such as How to Be a Missional Church, How to Lead Worship, How to Have a Good Marriage, How to Do This, How to Do That. We are seemingly more fixated on the techniques rather than on the theory or the theology. We are fixated on the how questions, but we seem to be no longer interested in asking the what questions or even the why questions. Basically, we live in a world where it is more about how you feel rather than what is the truth. We live in a world where following a fad seems more important than following Jesus. We live in a world where being fashionable is given more attention than being faithful. And that was the message that Peter was telling his congregation, the people that he had a relationship with in building them up, that they need to keep paying attention to being faithful and in that sense to grow in the Lord. My colleague, the Dr. Liao Ting Huat, has written an article for Ethos website entitled, What is the Gospel? In the article, Ting Huat bemoans the fact that Christians often present the gospel as, and I quote, promising salvation only for the spirit part of human beings, with everything else in the world, the material bits, going into oblivion as at God's final judgment. This fits perfectly with the Gnostic narrative, since the destruction of this material world represents the defeat of the demiurge and his evil schemes. End of quote. Right? If you think about what is the gospel, we often think in terms of Gnostic ways. That's basically what Ting Wan is saying. Sadly, we are more Gnostic than we are Christian. And this confirms Ting Wan's assertion that Gnostic versions of Christianity presented a major threat to true Christian faith in the early centuries of the church. Although they eventually faded away, the influence of Gnosticism on Christianity is still evident. And I would say, even today. Right? Peter, in his final address, reminds us to be grounded in true knowledge. And he was contesting Gnosticism at that point of time as well, for which his use of the word epinosis versus gnosis. Gnosis is from where you get the word Gnostic. Right? So he is talking about true knowledge. But church, maybe the question we have to ask is, how can we grow in true knowledge? And this is why I have to be honest with you to tell you that I do not have a three-point sermon or a list of steps that you could take to grow in knowledge, because this is not a how-to sermon. I do not want, but I, however, do want to challenge us to learn to love the Lord with not just your heart, with not just your soul, but to learn to love Him with your minds. Right? Learn to love the Lord with your minds. The Christian faith is indeed a reasonable faith. What troubles me most among youth and young adults these days is the way that we allow our emotions to dictate our decisions. We live in a postmodern culture where everything is subjective. We live in a culture where truth is relativized and where personal opinions are more celebrated. And in many ways, we have abdicated our minds to the machinations of popular and a consumeristic culture of our times. And sadly, even the church is not exempt. Peter reminded the church that there is a clear and present danger of false teachers lurking around. How do we discern the fakes from the genuine? Interestingly, there is a correspondent in ascertaining counterfeit currency, where a person who wishes to be discerning must focus more on what is genuine rather than what is counterfeit. The way a sort of inspector of money sort of knows what is a fake and what from what is real is for the person to feel and know the paper and the ink on which the genuine currency is printed. Right? Obviously, this doesn't apply to cryptocurrency or your pay now and pay la accounts. Right? But if you want to know whether a bill is real, feel the real thing. Get a sense of it, and if you keep feeling it, you realize that when you feel a fake note, you know immediately. So you get to know the fakes by knowing the feel of what is genuine. In other words, the more acquainted one is with the genuine, the more sensitized one will be when confronted with a fake. In the same manner, the more we understand what is true, the easier it is to identify what is fraudulent. The more we know about God's character, God's ways, and God's word, the greater the contrast will be between the truth and as well as the error that we will be subjected to. And hence, I can only point us all to the truth of God's word. If you are looking to grow in true knowledge, the one book I ask for us to turn to and to study seriously is the Word of God. And I'm thankful that today you have a dedication of these cell group leaders to remind you that that is basically what we are supposed to do, an honest and a focused study of the Word of God. Read it, discuss it, mull over it, think through it. That's where TTC fits into the scheme of helping us grow in the knowledge of God's Word. Right here, allow me to do some advertisements. Now, I think, honestly, that it will be great as a result of this sharing today that all of you will respond to this sermon and consider God's call for you to be trained theologically at Trinity Theological College. Registration for the July semester is opening in November. But seriously, if not full-time theological training, perhaps some of you might consider signing up for the evening equip courses that will spur you to think deeper about the Bible and about the Christian faith, about the things that you're faced with in life. And these courses will again begin in January 2025. But besides attending courses, I think perhaps what is more important is that you begin this journey of loving the Lord with your minds by embarking on the spiritual discipline of reading. Right? By embarking on the spiritual discipline of reading. Reading His Word, that is primary. And also reading some good theological books. Reading to expand your knowledge. Reading to sharpen your minds and to keep a storehouse of godly wisdom. We live in a world where we are daily bombarded by alternative gospels. How else can you know what is truth if you do not exercise the mental and the intellectual faculties in critiquing the popular culture of our time? Just a few questions and issues for you to consider, for you to ponder upon, right? What is a Christian response to the movie, if you have not already watched it, How to Make a Million Before Grandma Dies? I do not know if anyone of you have watched this, but if you have not, it's on Netflix, right? Go and watch it as a cell group and then discuss maybe the Christian implications of that. That's something that we can do as we think more deeper about the issues of our life situation. What about Shusaku Endo's novel and the movie itself, Silence? How do we understand persecution in the context of Japanese Christianity, and how does that apply to us? How biblical is the teaching of rapture by some so-called prominent teachers? What are the doctrinal concerns with the prosperity gospel? Right? What is wrong with the prosperity gospel? How do we make a response to that? What is the Christian response on the issue of climate change? How should we make sense of the geopolitical events of today? How do we grapple with the unabated civilian casualties in the Gaza Strip? Right? Think about that. That is a theological issue as well. I don't think that these are the purview of a select few in the Christian academia, such as Trinity Theological College. But these are indeed issues that all of us as disciples need to be concerned about. How long do you wish to remain as spiritual babies and eat regurgitated food? Right? How long do we want to be eating regurgitated food? Can you imagine once we go down for a tea break that all of us are going to go down and take up bottles of smashed carrots or pears for our so-called time of just having some time together downstairs. All of us will be eating just smashed up food, right? That isn't what a normal a growing person would actually be feeding on. And spiritually, we shouldn't be eating regurgitated food all this time. Do you not long for solid spiritual food in learning to love the Lord with the discipline of the intellect? When was the last time you read a good Christian book? Right. So instead of scanning your eyes with pictures of what next to buy, especially I know that 11/11 is coming, right, and filling your minds with all kinds of internet junk, why not invest your time and attention in reading a good Christian book? Besides reading the scriptures, why not consider ending this year and beginning the new year by reading a Christian book? How about Mark Knowles' The Scandal of the Evangelical Mind? Why not set yourself a goal of reading one Christian book a month? Maybe that's a bit too challenging. Perhaps one Christian book a quarter. That will mean that you have read 4 books in a year. All right? And if you think about this, you don't need to do this alone. Get a buddy, get your spouse, get your cell group to read the book together with you, so that practically you can say that by the end of 2025, you would have read X amount of books that will have helped you to learn to love the Lord more with your mind. Or perhaps you can sign up for the church's D&N programs. I guess in Aldersgate, you may have Disciple One, you may also have other causes, which will act as a way to ensure that you are reading God's Word, you are growing in knowledge, and you're actively thinking about what it means and how to live that knowledge. I started my sharing with the Arian controversy, and I guess I should also end this sharing with the story of how this one man who chose not to compromise stood up against Arius, the tall, dark, and handsome charismatic preacher. this guy who is considered a dwarf, his name is Athanasius, the champion and the defender of orthodoxy against Arius' teaching of homoiousios, that Jesus was of similar substance as God the Father. Athanasius was insistent that Jesus was homoousios with the Father, meaning of exactly the same substance as God. So to Athanasius, this was no splitting of theological hairs. Salvation was at issue here, and only the one who was fully human could atone for human sin. Only one who was fully divine could have the power to save us. And so Jesus had to be exactly of the same substance as God. There was no other way around it. The Emperor Constantine, who was more concerned with political unity rather than theological truth or doctrinal accuracy, called a meeting of bishops to settle this raging dispute. About 300 bishops met in Nicaea to hammer out this doctrine, and in that process, we became the beneficiaries of the words of the Nicene Creed that we had read this morning. That we can say we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, right? Homoousios with the Father. He is not only of, unlike what Arius would say, similar substance, he is totally of the same substance, which is why Nicaea would go on to say, God from God, true God from true God, light from light. You notice that that was basically how it was constructed. So we are the beneficiaries of this person who wanted to defend the truth. Though Arius was condemned, a heretic in exile, he and his followers managed to wiggle their way back to imperial favor and through conniving ways turned the tables on Athanasius. Constantine ordered Athanasius to restore Arius to fellowship, a proposition that Athanasius would not comply or compromise with, which resulted then in Athanasius being exiled, right? Based on trumped-up charge of treason or corruption. Athanasius was to be exiled a total of 5 times under 4 Roman emperors, but each time he held to his conviction, immovable and steadfast. In writing the introduction to the English translation, one of Athanasius' most important work on the Incarnation, C.S. Lewis has this to say of this defender of orthodoxy. C.S. Lewis, and I quote, "His epitaph is Athanasius contra mundum," meaning Athanasius against the world. "We are proud that we, our own country, has more than once stood against the world. Athanasius did the same. He stood for the Trinitarian doctrine, whole and undefiled, when it looked as if the civilized world was slipping back from Christianity into the religion of Arius, into one of those sensible synthetic religions which are so strongly recommended today, and which then is now included among their devotees, many highly cultivated clergymen. It is Athanasius' glory that he did not move with the times." He did not move with the times. He stood firm in his orthodoxy. Church, may we be like Athanasius, as one who is thoroughly grounded in the knowledge of God's word, steadfast and immovable, undefiled and always standing up for the truth that is found in God's word. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.